Good morning. We're going to go ahead and get started. And if additional people come in, we can accommodate them into what we're going to be doing. Again, my name's Frank Markley. This is Marty Mahler. If you were here as part of the strategic planning components last time, welcome back. If you're new, welcome to what we're doing today. I don't think it'll be hard to pick up, even if you weren't here last time, where we are today. We're going to review what we did last time and then jump one step forward. So at this point in time, just to give you an idea, we're on step two right now. Last time we were here, we talked about a gap and SWOT analysis. We presented some information about the college and externally what's going on. Today we're going to talk a little bit about trends and best practices. We're going to review the SWOT analysis, and we're going to, in essence, work on what we call strategic issues. And so from that perspective, we've got really two things for you to do today. One is to, in essence, review the outcomes of the SWOT analysis to inform us some of those things. And then after we go through some of this trending, we're going to talk a little bit about strategic issues, and we're going to ask you to develop some strategic issues from that analysis. So let's start with where we left off last time. And for those of you who participated online or in one of the open forums, we in essence identified what we call the SWOT-C. Strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. We added a dash C, which is challenges, which we'll talk about in just a minute. So one of the goals that we had and one of the processes in the planning components that we're going to be doing is we're taking these strengths and turning them into opportunities. And we met with the Faculty Advisory Committee yesterday, and we listed those strengths and how they can be used to create opportunities or potential opportunities. So we've already started this process of taking that SWOT analysis and beginning to understand how the strengths of CCRI can be used to create those opportunities or look at those opportunities moving forward. So last time we were here, we had open forums on three different campuses, and we had also the survey online where you could take the exercise via a link on Strat Plan, part of CCRI's website. And we had about 145 responses, people involved, and also those who responded online. Now, here in essence is a sort of a tally of everything that we've put together. Keep in mind that the information that we're going to feed back to you today are verbatim responses from what you provided us. We didn't edit, we didn't take out the sometimes harsh language or criticism. We left everything there because, again, our goal is transparency. You should be able to, if you remember what you did last time, you should see it in the analysis, or you should be able to point to some of those different things. So you can see that we took that information and we developed themes. When each of the groups met and created their strengths and weaknesses, opportunities and threats, all that information, you can see that for strengths there were 138 responses. And we took those responses and kind of combined them into light groups. We call them themes, and you'll see that in just a minute. And the greatest strength was affordability and accessibility. The greatest weakness was lack of internal and external communication. And external communication is the marketing component. So opportunities, the greatest opportunity was new programs or partnerships that were identified. And then the greatest threat was the competition, whether it's New England Tech or another institution, RIC, or you know, the university. Those were all mentioned as your greatest threat. Now, the greatest challenge were mostly internal factors, things that you have control over. And you'll be able to see those in just a minute. So do we have any members of the Strategic Planning Committee here? We do. We got two of them, okay? So we would like members of the Strategic Planning Committee I'm trying to think if we've got one group or two groups. Maybe it's best to form one group and together. We have here the outcomes of the Strategic Planning Committee's work, and what has transpired is that the SWOT analysis went to the Strategic Planning Committee last week. They reviewed it. They, in essence, validated it. They looked at themes. They created some strategic issues. We took that information and comments. We reformulated the SWOT analysis, and Robin has it right here. So the Strategic Planning Committee is, members are very keenly have reviewed this information. So what we'd like you to do is to potentially get into one large group. And we'd like you to, in essence, take a few minutes to review the themes. We'd like for you to get together and talk through some of those different things. I guess what we're trying to understand is, do those responses convey the accurate, are they an accurate portrayal of some of the circumstances at CCRI? What is the most surprising responses? And then, if you remember this slide here, yesterday we started to think about how those strengths can be turned into opportunities. So we'd like you just to spend about 10, 12, 15 minutes going through this, understanding this, dialogue with one another about some of those different things, and then we'll come back together and move forward. But the goal is, again, to just to get you familiar with some of the responses and what people are saying. You'll be using those as we move forward in the rest of the presentation.
Kind of runs counter to the image of CCRI as a place where you can learn how to ride a motorcycle. It's tougher to take the Calculus 2 class here than it is at URI.
Okay. So that, obviously, the perception image in terms of who is attending as a student is very broad now. We need to get out that message, so to speak.
Because we have a lot of, like, I teach in the business department. I teach day and work at night, and my nighttime students, even in the daytime, we have a ton of students who are of all ages, all backgrounds, coming back because they want to totally change their career.
Yes.
So we need to get that out there, that, you know, this is the place to do it. Like last night, after one of my classes, I actually sat for a half hour and met with a student who, she's, I don't know, I'm gathering maybe about 40-ish and has been doing something for like the last 20 years and thought, you know, I really want to do something else, so I need some guidance.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, you know, I'd be happy to help you. So we sat down and kind of mapped out like what she's already taken, what she likes to do, and something like that. So I think we need to have a better reputation outside of here.
Okay. So again, that points to one of the weaknesses that we've seen, which was that, I guess if you look at on page 5, lack of internal and external communication, a lot of those things are related to marketing, getting that sort of that word out, and letting people know that CCRI is a lot of different things to a lot of different people, and tell those success stories.
Yep.
And let the people tell those success stories as well.
And I really think we should do that, because like I have like a lot of my collegiate DECA students who have failed elsewhere have come here and like blossomed and then gone off. That should speak. That's what we should be using for marketing. Stories from people who have turned their life around.
Oh, yeah. I think we heard the same thing yesterday as we were meeting with different representatives at the governmental level and so forth, that, you know, there are people here who graduated and went on to run very large businesses and very successful members of the community in Rhode Island. And we need to find those people and obviously let them tell their story about how they really got a start here and how that really changed their lives.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I really think, because that's our tagline, you know, change lives. And well, we should have the people whose lives have changed be the ones telling the story.
Yeah. Marty and I see that at many community colleges. The alumni come back and really are the supporters of the institution.
Not only that, but just career choice, because we have a lot of students who think they want to do something but come here and explore a little and then decide, wait, this is so, I've had students who say, if it wasn't for CCRI, I wouldn't be in the career I'm in now. It gave me a chance to explore at an affordable
Sure.
So that's, you know, that's mm-hmm. a part of that career choice, career change mm-hmm. that we need to okay. get out there.
Okay, good. Any other comments with regards to the SWOT? We're going to ask you to, in a little bit, to use this information to begin to craft what we call strategic issues. So you'll be using this, but I wanted to get your first reaction to this. Anything there that was surprising? Anything else that caught your attention that Marty and I should know from a planning perspective?
Well, I just have a comment.
Sure.
So it looks like you just took everything that we said in the meeting and kind of compiled it.
We compiled it into themes, yes.
Into uh-huh. themes, right? Yes. So but as looking at this, like mm-hmm. my question is, obviously the people who did this are part of the institution, so you come right. in with your own perception or idea sure. of what CCRI is, and that where you play a role in the institution obviously shapes that. So how much of this is, so what we perceive is our strengths, right? How much mm-hmm. of that is actually accurate? What we perceive is our weaknesses.
Yes.
You know, is that really our perception, or are these truly weaknesses, or is yes. this something that you would typically find in a large community college, mm-hmm. or our threats? Is that mm-hmm. truly what a threat would be, like, you know, toxic faculty or yes. whatever the threats are listed? So again, moving forward, how do we figure out, okay, this is actually factual. You know what I mean? These are areas where we're strong, we need improvements, or this mm-hmm. is, you know, an actual threat to the community.
Yeah. And that's a very good question. In the next piece, we're benchmarking to correct misperceptions. And absolutely right. That was a perfect segue into our section, actually.
That's what she's on the strategic plan.
There you go.
and present.
There you go. So I think as we move forward, this is a lens from many different participants and many different roles at CCRI, many different campuses. So those people have unique, their perspective is based on what their role is and how long they've been here and a variety of different things. Now, collectively, when you start to put all the things together and you read those bullets from that perspective, you start to get a breadth of those perceptions. Now, those are people's perceptions. The next piece of this, we're gonna have to start thinking about, well, are those perceptions correct? For the most part, what people have identified as threats and competition and things are things out there. We spent time with the Faculty Advisory Committee yesterday, and we talked about those threats. We talked about New England Tech. We showed the programs that they offer, and are there opportunities at CCRI to take and look at those programs? We showed some of the strengths and opportunities, and we started to dig into that. We had an hour and a half discussion with regards to that. So yes, we're in the process now of starting to break this down and really get to some of the fine details about that. So let me, if there are no more comments, let us go into some of this misperceptions. And so from that perspective, one way to look at whether or not your information is consistent with what's happening out there, let's say at other community colleges, is what we call benchmarking. So we're comparing your processes and performance to other institutions. And that's one way to do it. Obviously, when you go through accreditation, other people externally come in and look at you, the way you do things, and you're accredited, and then therefore that's another way. So benchmarking is just one of many different ways. So what we're doing is we're trying to identify the best colleges in a particular sector. We're trying to understand where similar processes exist, compare those results to your own processes. So we did that. We went out and we had a couple different groups. We had a group of New England institutions that are very similar in terms of your particular areas that make up the New England area. We had another group that was very broad, which contained hundreds and hundreds of institutions, and looked at that. And then we also took a group of what we call the top 25. And these are institutions, again, all U.S. institutions, all public community colleges. They're from various regions of the country. And the highest degree is the associate's, so we're not having institutions offer bachelor's degrees and so forth. The enrollment goes from roughly a little over 10,000 to almost 20,000. But these top 25 institutions in this benchmark study were recognized over the years by various organizations as top community colleges. And there's ways that they are recognized to do that. If you're familiar with one, which is called the Aspen Prize was just released here on the 24th of March. So there are 10 institutions every year that qualify for the Aspen Prize. Typically, you have finalists, semifinalists, and then the winner. And there's a very rigorous process of quality in terms of how you submit and how you become to that. There's also the League for Innovation in Community Colleges, and those institutions are leaders in a lot of the different things. It's a very select group of institutions who are leaders moving forward. Now, there's also, these institutions were also recognized in the press, in the media. You probably have understood U.S. News and World Report's ratings of colleges along the way. They're also recognized for their high graduation rates. So we just didn't want a group of institutions that, we're trying to build a world-class organization moving forward. So it makes sense to compare you with others. So this is, in essence, where you are. This is based on the integrated post-secondary education statistics data system. And so we started with sort of some metrics just to identify you. This was your full-time equivalent fall enrollment. You can see that the comparison of those 25 institutions was about 8,654 in terms of a fall FTE. You were at 8,650. So they're collectively, as a group, they're very similar in size to you. They're not huge. They're not very small. Collectively, as an average, they're very similar. You can see their head count. You're a slightly higher head count, but you're a slightly lower FTE to headcount ratio. Now, what's important is this is the Black African American population. The comparison was slightly lower than you, but in terms of Hispanic Latino, 34% of the students in that group on average were Hispanic Latino students, where you have right now roughly reporting about 20%. So a much larger diversity of population from the Hispanic Latino perspective. So these are the success and completion rates. So when you look at full-time retention for fall 2015, the comparison average was 70%. You reported 63%. When we look at the 150% full-time, first-time graduation rate for the total cohort, you're reporting a 14% graduation rate for fall of 15. The comparison average was 34%. So the transfer out rate was 14% here. You're reporting a transfer out rate for that year, 14-15, of 22%. So you can see that, in essence, you're transferring out. These institutions, for most part, are graduating, or more students are getting the degree and lower. But still, overall, if you look at the two, they're still very much higher in terms of their graduation and their 150% and their transfer rate. Now, number of students receiving an associate degree, the comparison 25 on average, 1,306 students. You're graduating a little more. But here, I think, is what's important, is those number of students receiving certificate of less than 1 year or less than 4 years. So it could be a degree that certificate that's less than 1 year, 9 months in duration, but not 4 years in duration. So on average, those institutions are granting 864 certificate degrees. You're granting, in essence, 316 degrees. So as we move on, we also want to look at the total staff. And one thing that was said was, well, you know, we lack the staff. We lack the faculty. So the total FTE staff of, and again, this is not our information. It comes from IPEDS Human Resources. So it is reported as part of the IPEDS package. The comparison average had 702 FTE in staff. You report 814. Now, when you look at total student FTE per staff FTE, basically roughly 12.3 student FTE per staff, you're at 10.3 FTE per staff. Now, instructional FTE, you can see again right here, the comparison average was 366. You have almost 490 instructional FTE. Now, those could be faculty, those could be lab technicians, those could be people who are directly related to instruction. Not all these positions, obviously, are full-time faculty. And then the total student FTE per instructional faculty, as you can see right here, is a little bit higher. Some cases, this is very favorable to you because you have a lower FTE to faculty ratio, which means more faculty per student FTE to help those students when they need it. So in some ways, this could be viewed as positive. In other ways, obviously, you can see that you do have, for the most part, quite a disparity between what the comparisons have are working with and what you have in terms of that ability to work with students.
When you look at the 1,200 some community colleges that are around the country, obviously one of the major functions most community colleges take on is a workforce function, and it can be both in the form of credit programs as well as non-credit programs. So we've been working on a project since, I guess, last fall and into the early part of this year. And this is just sort of a summary of some of the community colleges that we were working with. And essentially what we did here is we did kind of a qualitative research in terms of we identified these colleges as some of the higher performing colleges in workforce development. And then we conducted actual, they were submitted a questionnaire, and then we followed up with an on-phone interview to collect some of this information here. And you can kind of see these colleges and what the closest city was. So they're kind of all over. So here we're in Maryland, we're in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, Charlotte, North Carolina, and Seattle, Washington. Just sort of shows you. I think the thing, though, that really want, I think the major thing that you want to have as a takeaway from this is right down here, really, when you look at the opportunities that doing workforce development creates for the college as a whole. Because you can see here's a college that they're basically, now this is revenue, so this is net. This is what they bring in. So this is almost $14 million that they put into the college budget that, it isn't dependent. They still get their state funding, they still get, tuition. But here's another $13 million that gets dumped into the hopper every year because of the money that they make. And you can see here's Anne Arundel, that's not too far away in Baltimore. There's basically $10 million. You can see some are smaller, here's $2 million, but even $4 million here. But you can see that there, it's quite lucrative to get into that workforce development area just because of the positive benefits that it creates. And I said yesterday in one of our meetings, I said, workforce development does not have to be mutually exclusive to the academic mission of the community college. Obviously, there's 1,200 some community colleges operating around the country that do both. They have a dual mission. That mission is obviously academic and transfer students to four-year institutions, but it's also this workforce piece, both in a credit and a non-credit side. So I think it's something that that this college has a ton of opportunity to move more into. I know the college does some things, but to move more into that workforce development arena, both on the credit and non-credit side. And the benefit here is going to be that it'll take time to get there, because you don't just start, it's like any business. If you kind of look at it as a business, you don't just start up and you're just instantly making, printing money for the college. It's going to take some time. There's going to be external partnerships that need to be formed and re-enhanced, but it's going to take a pretty healthy internal partnership too between academic departments and the other areas that are doing the workforce development. But a huge opportunity. I don't know how else to explain it. It's a huge opportunity. And if you look at nothing else than this stuff right here, you ought to be saying to yourself, "Wow, this is pretty interesting here. What can we do to begin to move more in that direction?" So that's just kind of the point of this particular slide. Questions or anything on that? Yes, sir.
Why does CCRI have the money to build a dental hygiene school and private colleges don't? But private colleges have the money to build a cooking school and CCRI doesn't. Is there anything that keeps one from doing what the other's doing?
Well, obviously, I'm not going to claim to be an expert on the policies and legislative mandates here in this state, but obviously, you know, depending on what those are, you know, short of those, no, I mean, I think it really comes down to, you know, every institution gets a budget and priorities are set. They look at, you know, workforce needs. They look at a variety of metrics to decide where is the best way and what's the, you know, how should we invest our budget. Part of what we're doing through the strategic plan is to help actually inform that process, because if you have a well-developed strategic plan, that plan ought to be saying, look, we can't be all things to all people, but here's where we're going to focus our efforts, and we want to be, you know, really good at certain kinds of things. And so I you know, hopefully that answers your question, but no, I mean, I think that, you know, this process should begin to help drive some of that in some ways. But every institution, I think, at least the ones I've worked with, and I think Frank, you know, he can jump in here, but, you know, obviously every community college that I've worked with, they don't have a blank check just to do whatever it is they want to do. So they have to be very intentional about what they're going to do, how they're going to work with student success, how they're going to address what the business needs are, how they're going to address academic transfer with the surrounding institutions. You have to be intentional because, again, you know, there's not a pot at the end of the rainbow where it's just unlimited. You know, we've got Dave sitting here. He knows. He there's only so much you can do with the resources that you get. So it really comes down to, as a collective community college family, just like you're budgeting for your own family, as a community college family, who do we want to be and where do we want to go? And where do we want to focus our resources?
I think a lot of the answer to this gentleman's question is about demand.
Yes.
You know, if there's not a big demand for, you know, low-level culinary arts in this state right now, there is a demand for these dental hygiene programs, and they're high-demand, higher-wage jobs. Mm-hmm. Maybe not high-wage by some standards, but
I think that explains a lot of it, is that at least from what we heard, is that the community college, CCRI, is really interested on providing the skills for students to go out and make a living wage. Some of the culinaries are $10, $11 an hour, so they spend that money in tuition. Those are very expensive programs, like your nursing program is very expensive. And you don't charge a differential tuition rate for nurses versus those who are here for just to get their liberal arts and general ed for transfer. So everyone pays, in essence, the same. Now, at some of those private institutions, they can charge $20,000, $30,000 a year for culinary, because my brother went to one of them when he first started out. And but that covers the cost. You can't do that. It's very expensive to create kitchens. It's very expensive. I used to be in that business to run those programs. And so you have to balance that with demand, with the wage that the student's going to come out. Can they repay the loans once they're done? Can they advance? It's those types of decisions that really have to be made.
We have a neighbor right next to the Warwick campus, Kent Hospital, and a friend of mine is the chief of staff there, and he's telling me he can't find nurses. He's begging to find nurses, particularly for emergency room and operating room. And you know, we're investing in the sim lab and things like that for CCRI. But just one quick observation. Mm-hmm. I was glad to see that in the opportunities there's a lot about workforce development.
Yes, there is.
But there's kind of an old narrative now, and I think people are suspending their investment in it, you know, that CCRI is going to turn into a certificate mill.
Yeah, I understand.
We'll never be that, but there needs to be a good balance between traditional academic programs and workforce development. And I think we're getting past kind of the old fear of maybe some.
Well, a lot of them workforce. Fear. Yeah, a lot of workforce are people who already have advanced degrees or bachelors, and obviously they're not going to come here to take it over again, and they've been through that experience. So you're, in essence, you know, providing a service to much needed service in the area. And so whether it's a credential or a certificate, you know, they can coexist. You can still work with your traditional student and help for transfer. You can also work with workforce and a lot of the incumbent workers and workers that are currently employed. And those thrive side by side, as Marty said, in a community college, and that's critically important.
So I want to kind of, I was thinking about your comment earlier about, so you have this collection of all these comments here. And so I guess I wanted to kind of put a context to it so you kind of understand why this step is kind of important. So, you know, my wife and I, we like to go out to eat. So sometimes when I go to a restaurant that we haven't been to before, we look at Yelp. So if any of you have ever done this, you'll go on there and you'll look up a restaurant, and what do you find? You'll find five comments that say, oh, the wait was horrible, it's too long. And then you'll find five more comments that say, oh, the wait was perfect. We just got right in. So then you're left going, well, what does this really mean? What has it just told me then? Well, therein lies what part of this process is to do. You know, obviously, maybe my wife and I, let's just say our metric is we don't want anything more than a 30-minute wait. But others may say, well, no, I'd wait for an hour, and I wouldn't consider an hour wait. So that's what you got to begin to do, is you begin to look at what some people call a weakness, some people call it a strength. But what is right for CCRI? And you have to look at all these. And then you got to go out and you got to find the data that says this makes sense to us. If we believe that our transfer out rate ought to be 60%, and we look at different types of institutions and we see some that's much lower, we see some that's much higher. But for us, we got to arrive at a metric that makes sense for what you do here. Because what another college does doesn't mean that's what you have to do. But you do have to base it on a metric, because at the end of the day, you're going to want to be able to say, we chose this metric, and now here's how we're going to measure it, so that we know each year whether we're doing well in that direction or we're not doing so well. But I think the point of it is that you may have comments at opposite ends of the spectrum. What the work comes is determine what's the one that fits, that creates that happy medium, that is a good measure for what CCRI does in any of these areas. That's really what the work that we're asking the participants to look at and do. So. Yeah. You know, you made a good observation, and it's just, you know, how you approach that. So one of the things that, before we get into this and you kind of move forward, we wanted to look at some trends and best practices. And so we've understand that the college has engaged a consultant to begin working with career guided pathways. And this is just a kind of a review for sometimes this term is new and sometimes people maybe haven't, but, you know, in a nutshell, you know, it's mapping pathways to students and goals. It's helping students explore and enter the pathway, keeping students on their pathway, and ensuring that students are learning across their program. And a pathway can be, you know, there can be transfer pathways. So you might have a transfer pathway to one of the four-year institutions here in the state in health sciences, or you might have a transfer pathway in math, or there's pathways that are more career-oriented, so dental hygienist, whatever it might be. So there's all kinds of pathways. There isn't just one type. And again, I would say, for this institution, you got to figure out, you know, who do we want to be and where do we want to go, and then create those pathways that take you to that thing. So that's really the important piece. There's some research out there in terms of guided pathways, and I kind of talk about. There's two that I kind of see. It says, you know, in terms of having too many choices leads to indecision, procrastination, and self-doubt. So this is what we see. This is part of the reason why pathways were created. We have a lot of young people. I used to be a high school instructor. And, you know, what I've always said is we had high school, 400 students. We had four guidance counselors. So if I took the minutes in a day by a guidance counselor, divided by the students, it meant that the guidance counselor had about, you know, 3.5 minutes for each student in a day, you know, whatever that number is. So the bottom line is that we have a lot of young people that are exiting high schools that have absolutely no clue what it is they want to do. So they come to a college such as CCRI, and they're going to take a few hours over here, a few hours over here, and pretty soon they've got 60 hours, but they don't have enough credits to graduate in anything. They become frustrated, boom, they're gone. So that's part of the reason why they were handling them. Students benefit when they have clear learning goals and a concrete sense of how they're progressing towards those goals. I don't know any human being that doesn't like to know where they're at. You'll see students that come into a class, how am I doing today? You know, what did I get on the test? They want to know. And that's what a pathway does. It's almost like a fundraising project. You see the thermometer that shows how you're, that's what they want to see. They want that constant feedback of, hey, I've got, my pathway is 15 courses. I'm done with 7. I got 8 more to go. Those are the things that really create that different type of a learning environment when you go to a pathways type approach. Here's just a couple of you know, again, I go back to the research. Right now, the pathways have been around, I'm going to say, for a while, but most of the research that's been done has been on a small scale, and no one yet has, that I'm aware of, has taken a broad-based approach and said, let's round up all these projects that and colleges that look at career pathways and guided pathways, and let's come up with a set of metrics to see what does it really do at the end of the day. There's some small stuff, and if you look at the small studies, you can see here, this is IBEST from Washington, and you can see that the light blue are the students who were in the basically the treatment group where there was some sort of guidance to what they were doing, and you can see here earned college credit, you know, much higher than the students that were not matched into IBEST, earned an award, you know, look at the difference here, gained on basic skills tests, you know, that 20% increase over that. Here's another study that was done out of City University Accelerated Study Programs, they call the ASAP. Again, you can see completion of associate's degree in any college in 2 years, you know, almost double. Completion of associate's degree at any college in 3 years, again, you know, nearly doubles it. So on small scale, we can see a lot of benefits coming from guided pathways. So, you know, it's a great thing. You know, you're just getting started down that process here at this college, but I believe that it's you know, it's a great strategy.
I think the reason we're talking about some of these things, obviously, is that strategic planning really starts to come together when you start to look at what other community colleges are doing and what we call best practices. So one of the things that we look at as we go through and develop strategic planning goals is to, you know, what are some of the best practices, but more importantly, what is the research saying about the effectiveness of those best practices? Now, Guided Pathways is in full implementation in multiple community colleges and states across the country. So from that perspective, we also, Guided Pathways is one area, but developmental education has seen sort of a resurgence in terms of research. So that states have adopted policies, take one example, co-requisite remediation, have been able to triple success rates in the quarter of the time it takes unprepared students to complete introductory college level courses in math. So when you look at this, this happens to be math and English. So this is the national, but these are, in essence, you can see Colorado and Georgia, Indiana, Tennessee, West Virginia, all develop statewide policies for co-requisite remediation. And you can see, in essence, where they've been in terms of their success rates and increases in the percent of students in terms of completing their remediation or their developmental study sequence. Perhaps the most convincing survey has been in what we call TBR, which is the Tennessee Board of Regents. They also, as a state, for all their community college, initiated a co-requisite remediation in English and math. And I'll highlight a little bit about the math. So this is, in essence, the blue is the prerequisite model. This was the fall 2012 cohort, and this was their ACT. And then no ACT in total. And then the green was after implementation of their co-requisite mathematics. And you can see right here the jump. And basically 51% of the students in co-requisite math passed the college level course compared to 12.3 who were not part of that program in 2012. So you can see the comparison between co-requisite math completion of traditional remediation. This is completion without it, and then completion, in essence, with co-remediation. So again, as we start to develop strategic goals, there is a considerable amount of research out there that suggests that some of these strategies are very effective in terms of things that you're going to need to do to move forward. Yes?
So just a point of information, we've introduced accelerated learning program.
Yes.
And co-requisite English program. We've had terrific luck with it.
Mm-hmm.
Our challenge now is scaling it up. We've introduced some co-requisite math with less success, but it's not as mature in terms of a program.
Good.
So
well,
we're
great.
On that pathway already.
Mm-hmm.
And with great success.
That's wonderful. I'm glad that that's working out for you. And I think you will see this as you move forward and start to scale that. But again, as we go through this, states have different methodologies for looking at this. This is, again, a proven blueprint for success. And so one of the things that, if you look at Virginia, for them, placement and diagnosis depends, your math sequence really depends on what your particular major or program of study is. So not all students are required to take the various college units in math. So if you're a STEM business administration, you're taking those units 1 through 5. If you're liberal arts, 1 through 5. But if you're career and technical education, you have curriculum specific pre-college units that may include algebra, may not include algebra, it may include advanced math in calculus. It really depends on what you're going to study to determine what level of sequence of math you need. And again, that's just another way to look at that. So I think the other thing that we want to look at is from the SWOT-C analysis was that a lot of you made comments with regards to college readiness of your students, not prepared to come into CCRI and in essence do college level work. And again, there is considerable evidence out there. This happens to be about from the 2016 Futures Conference that was held at Pima Community College last year. What some of the other institutions are doing in terms of success programs that bridge from high school to college. And you can see that there's a lot of things going on that that various colleges are doing to help with that. When we get into this best practices, again, this is from the Futures Conference, went out and asked 40 community colleges who participated in that Futures Conference, what are they doing for best practices in student services? And you can see right here, assigned advisors, mandated advising for first-year students, mandated advising for at-risk students. 63% had specific strategies for first-generation Latino, Hispanic, or African-American students. 67% had electronic advising management system. 60% tracked student progress towards completion. 78 of these had early warning components to identify at-risk students. So this is to the extent that colleges are going to, in essence, assure the success of their graduates moving forward. With that in mind, we have to keep in mind also that CCRI is also part of a larger system within within Rhode Island. So we have to, first of all, take our understanding from the mission statement. And I think the red, again, are things that you are, in essence, required to do that are more statutory with your relationship with the Rhode Island as a public tier institution. So there's certain clues here about what you're required to do or what your mission is. Obviously, degree granting, open access, high school graduates and returning adults, array of academic career lifelong learning programs. You serve a diverse population, excellence in teaching, dedication to all students, high academic standards, transfer and career success, diversity, community needs, contribute to state's economic development and the region's workforce. So you've got a lot of things that you're doing, different populations, different programs, different ways to measure that in terms of success moving forward. Now we also have to keep in mind that higher ed is changing. And you have, in essence, the Council on Post-Secondary Education and, in essence, their strategic plan called Sailing Ahead, Strategic Plan for Post-Secondary Education. Now, Rhode Island Community College is part of that. So from this perspective, CCRI, when you look at things called performance-based funding, improve rates of persistence, especially for traditionally underserved and unrepresented populations. Partner with institutions to expand college completion. Looking at improved curriculum alignment, general education core, best practices in reducing excess credits. All of a sudden, you start to see these themes reemerging. What's important? Well, in the future, performance-based funding is very closely tied to persistence, completion, retention. You start to see that the future, in essence, what you're going to be asked to do is very critical with respects to making sure that this institution can produce graduates and on a variety of, whether it's career, whether it's general education for transfer, whether it's workforce, those missions are very critical. So that is, in essence, the task at hand as we move forward with the strategic plan. Lots of good information, things that you are, in essence, from the external environment will be asked to do, more completion, more success of students, work with underrepresented students or underserved students, also more of a funding-based metric based on performance of that. So what we'd like you to do, we have about 45 minutes left or so. We obviously need to get you out of here on time because all of you have other things to do. We have a exercise that we would like you to participate in. It looks like we probably have one group here that we can do it with. What we'd like to do is what we call create strategic issues. We'll give you the materials to do that. But here is what a strategic issue is. At this point in the planning process, you've got the SWOT. It's just instinctual to say, now how do we solve these problems? Well, that gets complicated because obviously everyone has an idea how to solve some of these issues that were came up in the SWOT. And so the first goal is really not to look at solving anything. It's really to look at, how do we frame the things that we're going to solve first? Because once we start solving something, there's other things that get in the way. So when we look at a strategic issue, it's defined as a question or challenge affecting the institutions. We already talked about this, your vision, mission, core values, your resources, programs, also your processes, the financing, org structure, management, or the service levels and mix. They're also defined as questions an institution must confront in order to succeed. And we'll give you some examples of this. So the three questions in developing, I think, good strategic issues is, first of all, what is the issue? Again, we're not solving anything. We're just trying to identify what those issues are. So from this perspective, we're phrasing those issues as a question or a challenge that you can do something about. Now, the key is it probably has more than one solution, and that's fine. Again, we're not here to create solutions today. That's our next step. We want to simply know what are those particular challenges or questions. Then we want to discuss the confluence of factors that make the issue strategic. A lot of times when we get through this, you look at the SWOT analysis and you say, well, look at all these different things that were said about programs, or all these things are about communication and marketing. And then articulate the consequences of that particular issue, of not addressing the issue. So here's a specific example. So let's take the SWOT analysis, and if you look at opportunities, lack of viable programs, course availability, which is one of the weaknesses that have been identified, and these weaknesses, in essence, are from page 4 at the top. And there's certainly a lot of bullets there. So I've taken these bullets, and I started to look through this list. And you can see right here, need for more programs, need for job-specific, match between job demands and program offerings, not creating new programs, need for career pathways, more variety in majors, not enough two-year degrees. So again, we're not trying to solve anything there. We're simply asking the question in the form of, how do we summarize this? And a strategic issue could be, how can we reinvent existing programs and develop new programs that increase the number of students earning high-value credentials? So again, there are many solutions to this. There's not just one, there's many. But we're simply listing what the issue is. And really, that's what we're asking you to do today. I'll give you one more example. And this example is, again, this could be a very challenging issue if we're trying to solve it. But we're not trying to solve it. Now, in weaknesses, there is, in essence, a question about organizational culture and engagement. And you can see here, not enough collaboration. We need to improve morale, the culture of fear and high anxiety, cynicism, disillusionment, unable to respond well, lack of engagement is mentioned several times, disconnects, dysfunctional requirements, disillusion, engagement. Again, these are all very volatile issues. And we tried to solve it today. I'm sure that we could be here for many days and there'd be a lot of discussion about this. But again, we're not trying to solve it. We're simply saying, well, what's the issue if we summarize all of this? What is that particular issue? Well, here's one example. How can we develop an engaging organizational culture to thrive in the future while establishing a climate of trust and collaboration? And that's, in essence, now that can be solved in many different ways. And that's exactly what we're looking for as we develop a strategic issue. So from that perspective, we're asking you today, as we go forward, to develop some strategic issues around the SWOT themes. So obviously, as we look at ground rules, be as specific as possible. Try to keep your statements concise. Again, we're going to be summarizing these and bringing these back next time. I hope that, in essence, in this process, we don't really get down to focusing on individuals or group of individuals. I think it's best if we take this and keep this at a level where we're not accusing or saying, well, you know, faculty do this or X number or this department does that. Let's stay fairly professional about that. Try not to overanalyze or overthink those. I think some of these issues, obviously, like organizational culture, can get a little bit of heat. Everyone has the right to be treated with respect. And then, again, all points of view and opinions need to be recognized. So from that perspective, it'd be best if we could put you in probably one group for a discussion. But based on the SWOT-C analysis and your experience of working at CCRI, we'd like you to develop a list of strategic issues. Now, we're going to basically, you can develop strategic issues around strengths, weaknesses, threats, opportunities, and those are certainly viable. But just like I did here, it makes sense to go through. Maybe you highlight what are some of the key components of that particular. This theme happens to be organizational culture and engagement. But then start to summarize to say, well, what do all these things have in common? And really, what is the issue around all of these? Developing an organizational culture to thrive. So there's a little bit of creativity in here, so to speak. There's a little bit of interpretation. But again, that's what we're looking for as we move forward. So from that perspective, going the wrong way here. We'd like you to take, there we go. We'd like you to take about 35, 40 minutes. This is a very small group. You can probably get through this fairly quickly.
Number one, how can we maintain a high level of quality among staff, including promoting and developing colleagues within the organization, both including faculty, administration, and staff? Number two, how can the positive reputation of CCRI be articulated inside and outside the walls of CCRI? Number three, what student services processes are required to assure student success? And finally, number four, what does a culture of engagement and trust look like?
So I'm kind of preaching to the choir here because many of you are already on the strategic planning committee. But I think as we go forward, given the small size of this group, it's important that this exercise will be on the strategic planning component of CCRI's website. So encourage others to participate or to reach out to their representative. I think in the end, we will be back May 4th and 5th to start putting all this together and start to create from strategic issues, strategic goals. And that is a process, obviously, where we take a lot of this information and start to put some definition to it. You've asked, we're here today, we're asking the questions. Next time we come, we'll start to determine what those look like and start to develop those common themes for developing goals. So that's, in essence, what we have today. And this is what we'll be, first of all, doing at each of the open fora this afternoon and the two tomorrow, and with faculty. So we're hoping that we get a fairly robust list of strategic issues that we can then start to develop into some common themes as well. So, any questions? Okay.
Nope. Thank you.
Thank you very much.